Good afternoon to everybody. I'm Dr. Vandana Shetty, and I'm working in the Department of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry in NIMHANS. I'll be moderating today's Indians program. The topic for today is Autism Spectrum Disorders, Assessment and Management. And to discuss today's topic, we have with us Dr. Shreyoshi Ghosh. She is an assistant professor in the Department of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry. She has completed her super specialization DM from NIMHANS and later joined us back as staff. So she will be conducting today's classes. Any questions that you may have, you may address in the chat box. I'll hand it over to Dr. Shreyoshi. Welcome, ma'am.
Hi, thank you so much for that introduction, Vandana. So as she rightly said, today I'll be talking to you about ASD, that is Autism Spectrum Disorders. I do plan to show you a few videos also as part of today's talk, but in case we have any technical glitches, the links will be in the PPT and you can access those yourself. So autism spectrum disorder, as we all know, is a neurodevelopmental disorder, which essentially means that it manifests at a time when brain development is occurring very actively. We see typically impairments in social communication and interactions and in repetitive restrictive behaviors and interests, which we also call as RRBs. It's a major public health concern, and over the years what we've seen is that the prevalence of ASD has significantly gone up. What we do know is that there are no medical treatments available for this condition, but that in fact early diagnosis and early intervention leads to a better outcome. Many parents are concerned about the label of ASD. So for children who are quite young, whom we're not very sure or confident about the diagnosis, we could just say that they are at risk for autism spectrum disorder and start intervention as early as possible. So the disorder was first described by Leo Kanner as early as 1943. In the next slide, we will see later in some time about how Kanner gave the clinical description of autism spectrum disorder. And he described it as a disorder of social relatedness. Now, very soon after, Hans Asperger's also described a case series of children whom he called as little professors. And this became the classical description of what we know as Asperger's disorder in ICD-10. DSM-5 has given the term autism spectrum disorder. And this is the terminology that is now becoming very popular. And we're going to actually look a little more at the nosology and the classificatory systems and how really we have now arrived at this term of autism spectrum disorder, how DSM-5 has conceptualized it, and how ICD-11 will also follow suit. So like I said, this was Kanner's early clinical description of autism, which is in fact very similar to what we're going to see later, which will come out in the classificatory systems and their description. So he says about a child that this child wandered about smiling, making stereotypical movements with his fingers. He shook his head from side to side, humming the same three-note tune. He spun with great pleasure anything he could seize upon to spin. And when taken into a room, he completely disregarded the people and he instantly went for objects, preferably those that could be spun. So we can see how you're getting a clue about these social communication deficits with regard to disregard of people, how in fact he had alluded to restrictive, repetitive behaviors. For example, this tendency to shake his head from side to side, back and forth, the sort of very limited repertoire of interests, which is manifested in preference for only those objects that could be spun. So the prevalence of ASD, it keeps changing. So 2018 statistics at about 1 in 59. I was just checking the stats before logging on. Now CDC says 1 in 54. So these values keep changing. But what we do know is that there has been a trend towards increase in the prevalence. It's as with other neurodevelopmental disorders, it's seen more commonly in boys. So we see this in other conditions also, like ADHD, SLD, and we also see it in autism. Now, the question about why we're actually seeing an increased prevalence over the years, well, one thing is that there's better awareness, right? So, and there are also better screening instruments. ASD is being diagnosed with more finesse. Also, another possibility is that earlier, all the children who were being diagnosed with intellectual disability, some of them are being now diagnosed with ASD. So the prevalence of ASD has gone up, whereas the prevalence of intellectual disability may have slightly gone down. So these are some of the factors. Whether there is an actual true incidence, a true increase in the prevalence or not, is not something that we are completely sure about at this point. Right, so the classificatory system in ICD-10, as many of us will be familiar with, actually divided what is now seen to be autism spectrum disorder into several different subtypes. So we had infantile autism, we had Asperger's syndrome, we had PDD-NOS, we had Rett's, and we had childhood disintegrative disorder. Now, what has happened in DSM-5 and which will soon happen in ICD-11 as well, is that all of these subtypes have been merged or they've been collapsed to actually lead to the most current criteria or the classification as we know it. And here in DSM-5, what is most important, highlighted in red, are deficits in social communication and social interaction across multiple contexts, currently or by history. That's the first most important symptom category, and the second is RRBs, that is restricted repetitive patterns of behavior, interests or activities, which are manifested as at least two of these four, which is stereotyped or repetitive motor movements, insistence on sameness, highly restricted fixated interests, or hyper or hypo-reactivity to sensory input. So what we call as sensory issues. So an example of stereotyped motor movements could in fact be rocking back and forth. It could be hand flapping. It could be toe walking, right? So any of these stereotypical motor movements would fit this category. Insistence on sameness and inflexible adherence to routine is basically being very, very particular about, for example, food, for example, the people whom they like to interact with, daily routines. So children with ASD prefer to insist on sameness. That's the second point under the RRB group. The third is highly restricted fixated interests, right? So we saw the child who had a strong preference for objects that spun, and that would come here. And the fourth is sensory issues. So many children with ASD, we know they're extremely hypersensitive to sound. That's a phenomenon that we call auditory defensiveness. Many of them have an extremely keen sense of smell. Several of them have, in fact, a hyposensitivity to touch. So, you know, they don't perhaps feel pain as strongly as other children. So you need to kind of look out for symptoms like this and then see if they fit the diagnostic criteria for ASD. Okay, like I mentioned, symptoms should be present in the early developmental period. If the early developmental period is completely normal and you have a child who is manifesting with these sort of symptoms, perhaps at the age of 10 or 11 or 12, then we're certainly not going to make the diagnosis of autism. You need to have clinically significant impairment in social, occupational, or other important areas of current functioning. Now, why this is very important is because autistic symptomatology may actually be present in some mild or minor form across the population. So we're going to diagnose a disorder only if it is causing clinically significant impairment. And of course, these conditions should not be better explained by other conditions, like, for example, intellectual disability. So if you have a child who actually has IDD, and you're suspecting that this child may have comorbid autism also, then you need to see that for that child's cognitive level, so if he has a cognitive age of about, say, 3 years, does his social communication also match that 3-year cognitive level? If not, then you can say that he has a social communication deficit. And if he fits the other criteria, you may want to make a comorbid diagnosis of autism spectrum disorder. Right. So as we said, the change really between ICD-10, DSM-4 and now DSM-5 and ICD-11 is that there are two core criteria instead of three, and the subtyping has been removed. This language delay has been completely removed, right? And that makes sense because in some children who earlier fit the diagnosis of Asperger's, they didn't have any structural language delay. So it didn't really make sense to keep that particular point because, you know, in every other way they are autistic. And of course, what we saw is in DSM-5, the sensory issue symptom, that is the hyper or hyporeactivity to sensory input, has been added. And in DSM-5, we also have a new category called social communication disorder. Now, although this this particular diagnosis has not received a lot of empirical validation, yet they have introduced it for children who have only the social communication deficit without any RRBs. But we still need to know, and we need research to tell us how much really diagnostic continuity and how much empirical validity social communication disorder will finally have in the long run, and whether we should continue to keep it in our future classificatory systems. So now that we've understood about the criteria, how do we really sort of get to these criteria, or what are the kind of history or behavioral observations that we're going to need to make in order to really be able to fit our child into the diagnostic criteria? So with regards to that particular symptom category of social communication deficits, of course, you would need to ask the parent about this child's response to name call, about what has been the quality of eye contact historically, what has been the quality of social interactions, what has the play been like, right? Does he use echolalia? Does he have any of these restrictive interests or play? Have they observed stereotypies? And of course, you're going to also need to observe some of these things for yourself. For example, when the child is in your clinic in front of you, do you really see them pointing, right? So there are two kinds of pointing. One is proto-declarative pointing and the other is proto-imperative pointing. So proto-declarative is a declaration of interest, right? So if the child sees something that he or she finds interesting outside the window, they point and they try to show it to the mother. That's proto-declarative, as opposed to proto-imperative, which is essentially the child pointing to something that he or she needs, right? So they're giving an imperative or a command. Now, need-based kind of pointing or communication is usually seen earlier and more readily in children with autism, as opposed to proto-declarative or a declaration of interest. Now, from pointing, we move on to the next very important observation, that is of joint attention. So joint attention is essentially a shared attention or a shared enjoyment. So if you're observing this particular child pointing to something of interest, does he or she point to that object, right? Try to get the mother's attention or the caregiver's attention to that object. And then do they complete the loop by looking at the mother's face to see if he or she, if she has looked at the object, what is her response to it? And is she sharing this child's interest in that object? So when you see that kind of a shared loop of attention or of enjoyment, right? That is when you can say the joint attention is well developed. But if not, then you need to be on the lookout for whether this is also a sign of ASD. Now, most of these skills, whether it's pointing or joint attention, will be present by the age of 1 to 1.5. We'll be looking at some of these developmental markers later about when you need to actually be able to pick up some of these in order to say that it's taking too much time to develop or not. Okay. So in very young children, less than a year, it's very difficult to really say that a child is at risk or whether you know, there is the possibility that they may be autistic. But some research has told us that especially this point of low frequency of looking at people, of looking at human faces, that could be something you know, that puts young children at risk for ASD. So they have a preference to really focus more on inanimate objects as opposed to human faces. Also, you know, interactive games, smiling back and forth, affection towards familiar people may also be not very clear in young children. Now, from 1 to 3, of course, the other points that we were talking about earlier, most of those should become very, very evident. So we should see a lot of range of facial expressions. We should see good eye contact. We should see a lot of shared affect or enjoyment, what I was talking about, joint attention. There should be interest in other children. So children are usually engaging in what we call parallel play. So sitting side by side and playing by the age of 2. They would be more interested in cooperative or interactive play by the age of 3, right? So if these things are not happening between the age of 1 to 3, these are again some behavioral indicators that this child may be at risk for autism and warrants further screening and diagnostic evaluation. Right. So the social smile, right? The give and take, the joyful smile that a child gives when their caregiver smiles at them. We know that typically it comes by the age of 3 months or so. So if you don't see it by 6 months, that is certainly what we call a developmental red flag, right? There are several here. I will just point out a few for you. No babbling at all by 12 months is certainly a red flag. The first meaningful word, if it has not come by 16 months, some practitioners say 18 months. So we can say first meaningful word, if it hasn't come between 16 to 18 months, that is also a developmental red flag in addition to the other ones that you can see here. Now, one thing that is often a feature for many children with ASD is what we call as developmental regression, right? Now, 20 to 25% of children with autism have a history of developmental regression, which may be abrupt or it may be gradual, right? And it could affect only language or language and social, or it could affect more than, or it could affect several domains. Now, although this regression is seen, you know, as a part of the developmental course of many children with ASD, however, when we detect it in a child, we still need to rule out other neurometabolic disorders and epileptic encephalopathy. So regression would mean that you should get the opinion of a pediatric neurologist, do your neurometabolic screening, and just make sure that there isn't any other organic basis really for this child's symptoms. So about 10% of children with autism also have an identifiable chromosomal or genetic disorder, right? So fragile X, neurofibromatosis, tuberous sclerosis, Mittler-Leopitz, these are some of the genetic syndromes that you could be mindful of, right? Especially tuberous sclerosis is important to sort of, you know, keep an eye out for because it's associated with clear neurocutaneous markers. Fragile X also a very typical phenotypic sort of a manifestation. So if you suspect from your clinical examination that there may be an underlying genetic syndrome, it is worthwhile asking for genetic testing. So like I said, things like MRI, EEG, metabolic testing, genetic testing is not really warranted or not completely mandatory for all children. However, if you suspect a neurometabolic disorder, if there is a history of seizures, regression, right? Or if you suspect that this child has a particular underlying genetic abnormality, then in that case, certainly we may want to investigate further. Now, ruling out sensory impairment is extremely important because naturally a child with either visual or hearing impairment cannot be expected to have the kind of language and social skills as a typical child. So that is something that is in fact should be ruled out very, very early. In many countries, it's a part of, the basic screening of a newborn. But if it hasn't been done, then prior to confirming your diagnosis of ASD, you should certainly ask for it. So the differential diagnosis of autism spectrum disorder would be all of these. Now, a child with only speech and language disorder or speech and language delay, right, and without a diagnosis of ASD would be using nonverbal communication very well. So they may not have a lot of verbal repertoire, but they would be using pointing, gestures, and all of the nonverbal communication quite effectively sometimes to make their needs known, which is, of course, not something that we see very clearly in children with ASD. I've already spoken about how you can distinguish intellectual disability, or how you could, in some children, make a comorbid diagnosis of IDD and ASD. Now, children with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder or ADHD, in them, it may also be difficult to make a diagnosis of ASD, because even children with ADHD may be very hyperactive. They may not be making eye contact, right? Many of them also have a comorbid speech and language disorder. So they may not be able to communicate as effectively. So in such situations, it may be a little confusing to tease out, right? Because you're seeing a restless child, you're seeing one who's not making eye contact, doesn't seem to have very good social skills. So how do you say whether there is ASD or not? So usually in such a situation, we do try to treat the ADHD. And then once the attention span is a little better, we hope that the child responds to treatment, then you'll be in a better position to assess that were these social skill deficits, you know, more linked to ADHD, or are they, maybe, do they warrant a separate clinical diagnosis of ASD? So moving on to really the intervention, or what are some of the core aspects of intervention? So I'll give you an overview of intervention, and then I'll also let you know about our NIMHANS protocol and what we kind of try to follow here. So like I said, early intervention is very, very critical. Now, it's said that if the intervention starts before the age of 3, then the prognosis is in fact better, because we know that especially in the first 5 years of life, maximally in the first 2 is when maximum brain development and synaptic branching is happening. So we want to start early so that we're able to sort of regulate this development trajectory as much as is possible. Now, the intervention needs to be intensive. That is at least around, some programs even go up to 40 hours a week, but I would say at least about 25 to 30 hours in a week. So if you have a family coming to you saying that we've been going for speech therapy, but we don't really see much change, you need to ask them, how intensive has this intervention been? Is it that they've just been going for 3 hours a week, right? And nothing much else has been happening. So then you know that it's probably not going to be very effective. Now, naturally, if you want 25 hours of intervention in a week, then, you know, a therapist is not going to be able to give that much time, which essentially means that we're going to want a lot of family participation, right? So we need, and we always check this, that are the parents sitting in with the speech therapist, are they understanding what is to be done? Do they receive some homework tasks? And do they continue most of these activities in the child's day-to-day life? Do they continue this training as part of the child's daily routine? That is extremely important. Of course, the intervention needs to be individualized, and it needs to be tailor-made according to that particular child. For example, say a child who has a very keen sense of smell, right? So, and you know, is not very interested in anything else. So you may try to teach him language by using the sense of smell. So you give him different interesting items that he might like to smell, and when he smells it and he wants it, then you could sort of say, okay, you know, you want that, that's soap. Can you try to say soap? And then you give it to him. So we have to enter the child, you know, through enter the child's world through his or her own unique individual profile. And it's not a one size fits all kind of an approach that will work. Now, of course, the overview of the treatment, how we're going to plan it, how we're going to assess and do our baseline assessments, all of that should ideally be guided by someone with experience and ideally as part of a whole team. Now, many interventions or many developmental interventions even for children with developmental delay or IDD, will focus on all domains of development. So on fine motor, gross motor, language, social, all of those, adaptive. It's not that we are not going to be focusing on all of those domains for ASD, but we're going to target especially ones in which we know the child is likely to have a lag, which is the social area. So the social attention, peer interaction, the language, especially language that is functional, right? Not just some jargon speech or echolalia. Functional language we want. We want language used in a pragmatic context, right? So these kinds of areas which we know will be problematic for a child with ASD is what we will target more specifically in our ASD-specific early intervention programs. Now, of course, these developmental interventions are not going to reduce all your problem behavior. So they won't get rid of your tantrums. They won't get rid of all of that. So for those, you need to have a formal behavioral plan in place. So you need to do a behavioral analysis of the tantrum behavior. What is the antecedent? What is the consequence? And see if you can work out a way to address the problem behavior through that. It's very important to evaluate progress frequently and adjust as needed, because parents often, they get demotivated and they feel that progress is not really happening. So we need to keep track of whether this child is really being able to display any micro gains or not, to what extent, which domain is he picking up, which one is he not. And we need to be able to give this feedback to parents and let them know how their child is progressing. Right, so in NIMHANS, of course, we have initially a detailed assessment which involves history taking. We would want to know all of the child's milestones so that we can find out in which one he may be lagging, which one was okay. What were the progression of the symptoms? Is there comorbidity or not? So I know we spoke about differential diagnosis, right? Language delay, ADHD, OCD, but very often it's not a differential, and we'll be seeing many of these conditions co-occurring. What we do know is that comorbidity is more of a rule in child psychiatry rather than an exception. So is there comorbidity or not? What is the treatment history in the form of, have any medications been tried? For what have they been tried? What kind of developmental interventions have been tried? How intensive have they been? How effective have they been? We need to know all of this before we can provide any individualized recommendations of our own. We also need to ask for the family history. So there is a phenomenon called BAP, or broad autism phenotype, where essentially family members, or typically first degree relatives, often on the paternal side, so paternal, the father, then paternal grandfather, some of them may show this kind of odd eccentric personality, speech delays, SLD. We may see some of these, which would indicate that, you know, this child has received in part some genetic loading, right, which has gotten further compounded with various environmental factors. It could be intrauterine, like, you know, preeclampsia, could be gestational diabetes mellitus. And these factors have kind of combined to produce the autistic phenotype in this particular individual. So it's important to ask for all of this history. Then, of course, we need to do a behavioral observation along the lines of all those points that I mentioned right in the beginning. A detailed physical examination to try and check, are there any neurological red flags, or are there any dysmorphic features or any other pointers that may hint at an underlying genetic diagnosis. Then we need to check for the parental knowledge and attitude, any misconceptions, what is the typical day of this family. If parents do not know, or they don't have enough knowledge about the diagnosis, then, or if they have a very resigned kind of an attitude, then no matter how much you really try to talk about interventions, they may not be very effective. So that's something we need to find out. What are the, like I mentioned earlier, the important thing is, what are the assets and deficits of this particular child? What are the excess behaviors or the problem behaviors, and what are the likes and dislikes of the child? So if you know the likes especially, you can design your program with those. So you can use those likes as rewards for certain behaviors or certain skills that this child has picked up or is trying to pick up. Right, like I said, investigations, if warranted, formal assessments at baseline are extremely important. So Incline ASD and ESA are freely downloadable. I would strongly suggest that all of you download those and take a look. CARS, CONOS, ADHD, RS are paid. Now, in India, we're using Incline ASD to confirm the diagnosis of autism, and we use ESA to essentially score the severity of autism. So a score of 70 or above on ESA, which is Indian scale for assessment of autism, would indicate that this child has a diagnosis of ASD, and then you can further score it into mild, moderate, or severe. It's also important because on the basis of the scoring severity, we also give a disability certificate, which will then enable this child to get disability benefits. Now, Catherine Morris schedule is something we use here, but again, it's not freely available. There is a checklist called the Catherine Morris checklist, which gives you an entire baseline profile of what is this child's current ability. So in language domain, in social, in concepts, right? Where is this child currently? So that you know that this is where he is. And so I must then try to intervene at just one level higher. So this Catherine Morris gives you a baseline, and it then gives you, it basically teaches you skill by skill how to teach these individual things to the parents. Now, like I said, if you're able to work in a multidisciplinary team, that's really the best way to go about it. You would want interventions from your speech pathologist. You would want a neurologist to kind of look into this child if there are seizures or if there's a history of regression, and ophthalmology, ENT, of course, to rule out your sensory impairments. Okay, now after all of this assessment, when we start intervening, right? First and foremost, without a solid psychoeducation, you're not going to really be going to be able to build on that and get parents to follow through with all of the skills that you will be teaching. So you need to clarify misconceptions, tell them about the cardinal symptoms, tell them about the prognosis, what is the importance of training, importance of diary maintenance. So to keep a record of what skill that they're trying to teach, how did they try, to what extent did it work, what didn't work. Use of rewards in training to basically motivate the child to keep going with the training plan. And maintaining a baseline for all skills and behaviors, so we know where we started and then where we're able to reach. And very importantly, one should look for micro gains, right? Because parents will often not be able to see it. They may be comparing their child with another, typically developing child. So they need to be helped to identify micro gains and these micro ways in which their own child is moving forward. Now, after the psychoeducation, we of course need to move on to the training. So we would want to focus on eye contact exercises, imitation, attention enhancement, hand function, self-help skills. So again, we form a baseline, right, with Catherine Morris, or you can use any other baseline. There is the Comdeal developmental checklist also, which gives you a good baseline. And then we proceed to basically see how we can teach parents to address each and every one of these deficit areas. Now, speech stimulation is very, very important. Although I did say that language is now not a core feature or a core part of the criteria anymore, but inevitably, very often we do find that children with ASD also have a comorbid speech and language disorder. So you would certainly want to also, that's one domain that you wouldn't want to leave out and which the speech therapist can help you with, wherein you can have naming games, you can have a lot of storytelling, you can have a running commentary. So the child may be playing and then you sort of sit next to the child and you keep commenting or you keep talking about what the child is doing. Interactive play is extremely important because we know that as part of the social communication deficit of ASD, children tend to play solitarily. They tend to disregard other people. So how to break that and turn it into an interactive play is something that really needs to be focused on. Managing stereotypies, self-stimulation, managing problem behavior, temper tantrums, like I've said, all of these form an extremely important part of the training protocol. Now, again, the importance of an individualized, personalized treatment plan cannot be undersaid. The structuring of activities is very important, whether medications need to be given or not, right? So, if you're thinking about medications, what is the dose that you want to give it for? What is the duration? What clearly are your target symptoms, right? All of these need to be thought about in a lot of detail. Then, of course, the family will want to know that, you know, I have one child with ASD, so what is the risk for subsequent children? So that is something that also needs to be discussed with them. Roughly, we say that the risk for the subsequent child is about 15% or so. Different studies have differed on this. But definitely, if they're very concerned and you feel that, you know, a genetic test may be warranted, then you could also get an opinion from your geneticist about whether to go ahead with that. Now, like I said, a lot of the work will be done by the family, so it helps, if, especially if the family is well-educated, to give them a lot of bibliotherapy, right? So there is one group of centers that is established now all over India. It's called COMDEAL, C-O-M-D-E-A-L. So they have centers all across the country. It started in Bangalore by Dr. Pratibha Kanu. So they also have a lot of manuals that are available. So if the family is able to read these and access these, then that's an excellent source of information that you could refer them to. Now, of course, before discharge, before you let the family go, you would want to again kind of also help them to take a decision about school. So do they want to go for an inclusive school which has a separate resource room or which has facilities for a shadow teacher, or do they kind of want to, you know, partly send the child to a regular school and maybe separate time is kept for a resource room input. So how do they want to really take this decision is something that must be discussed with them. Okay. Now, like I said, pharmacotherapy is of course not recommended for the core deficits of autism. So social communication deficits and RRDs are not tackled with medication effectively. However, if you have a child who's aggressive and has a lot of stereotypies, then you may want to use a low dose of an atypical antipsychotic like risperidone or aripiprazole. If you have a comorbid disorder of ADHD, then you may want to consider whether to give medications like clonidine, atomoxetine, or methylphenidate. Now, we know that children are more susceptible to side effects of medication than adults. So you would want very close monitoring and very regular follow-ups if a child has been put on medication by you. Now, what we do know about the course and the outcome and the prognosis essentially is that about 3 to 25% of individuals with ASD achieve optimal outcomes. A rule of thumb is about 1 in 10, right? We will see improvements in almost all children, especially those who get intervention. So we will see improvements in communication, social interaction, pattern of the RRBs, but only about 10% or so show really optimal outcomes, which means that they end up functioning independently. Now we're going to look at, with regards to some of these outcomes, what are some of the indicators that a particular child may have a better outcome in adulthood. So IQ is definitely an important predictor. Those with higher IQs and a higher level of language development at about 5 to 6 years of age are likely to have more positive outcomes, right? Now, we've seen that higher IQ is associated with better education, better communication skills, as well as larger gains in self-care. And it's also linked with what we saw was the definition of optimal outcome. So they're more likely to live independently and achieve possibly some employment status as well. Okay. Now, like we said, probably the majority of children or individuals with ASD do, in fact, they are left with a residual impairment even in adulthood. So we have about 50% or 60% of children who leave school without formal academic or vocational qualifications, right? A minority of them actually are employed, and only about 5 to 10% would be married or in a long-term relationship. So on the whole, we do not see a majority of these individuals who want to live independently. But again, there are several factors that would be involved in prognosticating, which we will just summarize quickly in the next slide. So to sum up, when a parent asks you about, you know, what is the likelihood that my given child, this particular child, is going to have a better outcome? So a higher childhood IQ, right? So if a child is not really doing very well in terms of social skills or language, but you can see that they have a lot of cognitive reserve. So they're able to learn concepts quickly, they're able to grasp new ideas quickly, or maybe they have excellent visual spatial skills. So these are all indicative that there is possibly a fairly high childhood IQ. And this would enable this particular child to use some of this cognitive reserve in order to learn the skills that he or she is deficient in, like the social and the language skills. Of course, the severity of ASD in childhood is definitely a predictor. If a particular child starts out as having severe ASD, then of course his improvement graph will be in will show an upward trend, but may not reach the same, you know, level of achievement as a child with who starts out as having mild ASD. Also, what are the access to interventions that this particular family may have had in childhood and adolescence is definitely important. How intensive was the interventions is extremely important. What was the childhood language and communication level is also very important for us to know. So children who are nonverbal certainly you know, will not have as optimal an outcome as those who have been able to pick up some language. Also, do we have comorbid disorders that also may be, you know, kind of coloring the clinical picture? So if there are a lot of comorbidities, whether it is psychiatric like ADHD or neurological like seizure disorder, those would definitely also predict the outcome. So these are some of the resources, some of the important websites and some of the important books that that you could refer. The second one, which is the Kennedy Krieger one, is essentially a video that tells you about the early signs of autism. I could try and see whether it's possible for me to play that. But since we have about 15 minutes left, maybe some of these resources and some of these websites and videos you could check out on your own. And of course, now if you have any further questions, I'll be happy to take those.
Dr. Shreyoshi,
yes.
Do you want the video to be played?
I'm thinking we may not also have time because it's 3:45.
Okay.
So maybe we can share that with the audience later.
Yeah. Any questions from the audience can be addressed now. You can probably indicate on the chat screen and I can unmute you. Dr. Shreyoshi, Dr. Challa Krishna Vasan wants to know the role of nutrition in the management of autism spectrum disorder.
Okay, so with regards to nutrition, we don't have any very conclusive evidence. There is some research that had pointed to the importance of the CFGF diet, that is the casein-free, gluten-free diet, but largely this has not evolved into strong recommendation, anecdotally, it is supposed to help a small percentage of people, of children who have ASD. Some practitioners like to do a food sensitivity test in order to check whether, you know, maybe a child may be a fit for a CFGF diet. But largely, it is not really one of the recommendations, because often it leads to nutritional deficiencies if we actually try to, you know, tailor-make the diets to such an extent. Apart from that, in general, for children in general, and also those with neurodevelopmental disorders particularly, we try to, of course, avoid the use of any preservatives, artificial, you know, coloring, things like that, which may have an adverse effect.
Dr. Neeraj wants to know the outlook on stem cell therapy in autism and its practice in India.
Again, there is absolutely no evidence. We don't have evidence for chelation, we don't have evidence for hyperbaric oxygen, nor for stem cell therapy. And I think I saw in the chat box L-carnosine also. So these are fads that come along every now and then. And they're expensive. Parents are often at a loss of at what to do. And so these are offered to parents as, you know, a means of hope, really. But what we do know, what works is early intervention. Right? What works is really helping this child to develop skills, training this particular child. So that's what we really need to focus on, because that is backed now by decades of evidence, as opposed to all of these other things that keep coming and going.
Dr. Harshita wants a few words on Snozzolin, please.
Sorry?
A few words on Snozzolin. I will unmute Dr. Harshita so that she can ask us.
Okay, I have no idea what Snozzolin is. If you could tell me what sort of medication that is, then maybe I could try it.
Yeah, I'm just trying to unmute her. Just a minute.
I think Snozzolin is controlled multisensory environment for therapy in autism.
Okay. So most of the sensory interventions, whether it is sensory integration or Snozzolin, usually as a part of the occupational therapy component of treatment, we do try to, you know, address some of this child's unique sensory issues to some extent. But again, not a lot of evidence for any of these occupational
therapy. Okay. Dr. Sagar wants to know the components of genetic counseling in ASD.
So essentially, as I said, genetic counseling or genetic testing is not recommended in all kids, in all families. You would counsel a family to maybe go for genetic testing if you're suspecting that there is an underlying chromosomal disorder. You could give them the option if they're, you know, wanting to go for a second child. You could say that we could do a whole exome sequencing and we could try and see what may be the matter. But as such, it's not recommended for a majority of families.
Okay. Dr. Manasa Ram wants to know what are the early intervention includes, which therapies, and when to start speech therapy.
Okay. So early intervention essentially comprises of, speech therapy, occupational therapy. And when you need to start is ideally as soon as you detect that there is a problem. So we don't really believe in the wait and watch philosophy. So if a child, even at the age of 2 years, is lagging behind either in language or social skills, it's a good idea to start some form of intervention. Now, within speech therapy, there are different modalities of interventions. So we have more traditional ways, which is called ABA or Applied Behavioral Analysis. And now it has evolved to more naturalistic ways. So that's called NDBI, Naturalistic Developmental Behavioral Interventions, which are more generalizable. So they're not really as therapist directed as ABA. So that's more child focused, more natural environment focused, use of more natural reinforcers. The child's motivation is taken more largely into account. So focusing on the nuances of those interventions would require more time, but if you if you can connect to some of the videos which will be sent across, then I think you'd get some idea about the intervention and how to go about it.
Any other questions from the audience? We still have another few minutes, so if there are any other questions that can be addressed. That's it, I guess. So that brings us to the end of our program. Dr. Chetan, shall we wait for another few minutes for questions? Dr. Chetan, you're muted. We do have another few questions. Dr. Shreyoshi, Dr. Manasaram also wants to know what points have to be explained when we talk of prognosis to parents. And Dr. Vasan also wants to know if there is any role for antidepressants in the treatment of ASD.
Okay. Coming to the first question, the prognosis aspect. So I think if you can remember some of the points on the last slide, you could use some of those to prognosticate for your particular child. So if you have a child with mild autism, right, who has been diagnosed early, maybe at the age of 2, 2.5, or 3, has received fairly intensive interventions, maybe 25 or more hours in a week. Family, of course, has been extensively involved in intervention, has no major comorbid disorders, has some functional language at the onset of intervention and continues to develop more. Then all of these has a fairly good IQ. So, you're trying to teach a new skill and he's able to grasp it. So all of these would be indicators that the prognosis is likely to be good or likely to be better. You could use the rule of thumb saying roughly about 1 in 10 children go on to achieve optimal outcomes, may even not be on the spectrum anymore, and whether you think that their child is likely to be that 1 in 10 or not will depend on all of those factors. But it's important that regardless of whether we will be able to achieve an optimal outcome or not, that every child will show improvements in his or her particular skill set, in his or her abilities. So, and that itself is very important, because as a child acquires new skills, right, supposing he or she learns new self-help skills, is able to maybe get toilet trained, automatically, that makes him independent. It makes the caregivers, less continually involved with the child. So it reduces the burden on the family as a whole. So it's important to keep motivating parents, to look at these improvements, because it will have an impact on the individual and the overall family function.
Dr. Monica wants to know the role of gut microbes in ASD. And another question is the role of anti-epileptics in children who do not have epilepsy, but anyway, when it's used to treat autism.
Okay, I think I forgot the antidepressant question also. So there was some initial interest in SSRIs like fluoxetine in reducing some of the core features of ASD like stereotypies. But currently that practice is not really supported and research doesn't support it. However, the fact remains that a child with ASD or any other neurodevelopmental disorder can develop at any point an additional axis 1 comorbidity. So a child with ASD could become depressed in adolescence, or a child with ASD could develop OCD in adolescence, right? Which would then mean that for that condition, we may want to prescribe SSRIs, but not for the core symptoms of autism. With regards to the epilepsy question, there is no role for anti-epileptics in children with ASD who do not have epilepsy, essentially. So even for behavioral problems, risperidone does work better than valproate. If you absolutely need, maybe an add-on for aggression, you may want to consider a mood stabilizer, but as such, it doesn't fall as part of the recommendations. There's a lot of interest in the gut microbiota in ASD, but a lot of that is at the research level. So they've tried to do things like fecal transplants, etc. But again, all that is information that we're only starting to know something about. So things like fecal transplants also is maybe something for the future and something for us to be reading now. All of that is also not yet backed by a lot of empirical evidence.
I think that brings us to the end of our program. I would like to thank Dr. Shreyoshi for this wonderful presentation. It was very concise yet informative. And I think most of the questions that we had also got addressed. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shreyoshi. And thank you, Dr. Vandana, for moderating this session. We also like to convey our sincere thanks to Linux Laboratories for their support through educational grant. Thank you, Anandol. Next Saturday, we have Dr. Rajendra, who is Assistant Professor of Child and Adults in Psychiatry, who will be talking on depression and suicidality in children. And our videos, all the videos taken till now, are also available in our YouTube channel, Nimhans Indians. So kindly subscribe to our YouTube channel and kindly attend all the classes. It will be helpful for all of you. Thank you, Anandol. We'll be ending the meeting.